Mic test. Testing. Sound good? Gotten here maybe 10 minutes earlier and we figured this out.
I'm popping the mixer board over here with this mic. I just cut up the bearings or something too.
Mike. All right. Can you hear Mike Major? So you can't hear Mike Major talking right now? Turning up the Behringer. What can you hear, Mike?
Oh. 45-second delay. That's terrible. Must be going through Russia or something. I don't know. I've never seen all that stuff before. Oh, the people on the internet. Ah, so.
Okay.
Am I good? Can everybody hear me here? All right, so I just need to project here. Gotcha. All right. So, good afternoon, everybody. After several technical difficulties, it looks like we can finally get started talking about the future of Linux and what it's going to look like for end users. So I think we can all agree here at this point that if we look at server computers, supercomputers, and consider Android in the picture, Linux is already the most dominant operating system in the world. and there's not really anything that can even come close to competing with it. If you look at the, are these the desktop? Yeah, these are the desktop OS market shares for May of, from May 2021 to May 2022. And Windows is the clear winner. Linux is just about at 1%. But when we go to the mobile device market, or mobile device OS market, Android is the clear winner. Apple is, I think, about 40%. There's about a 40% gap in between Apple and Android. And that is a noteworthy gap. There's millions of more Android devices than, what do you call them, iOS devices. And again, if we consider Android a Linux distribution, which there is a ongoing debate, it uses a modified version of the Linux kernel. But, and oh yeah, and there's also the fact that Linus Torvalds has given his, maybe not seal of approval to Android, but he has commented on the plausibility of Android being the future of the Linux desktop. And he didn't refer to it as a Linux distribution, to my knowledge, but to argue against that would not only be ignorant, but it would, in a lot of ways, be pointless, because the debate's been going on for years, and if it hasn't been solved at this point, I don't think it's going to be. Anyways, skip through a few of these introductory notes. I didn't come here to talk about Android. If I were to get up here and just talk about how great Android can be for the future of Linux, then, hold on. Oh yeah, especially while using a MacBook, which I plan to virtualize Fedora on, but then the virtual machine kind of just stopped working magically when I got up here. And then the Asahi Linux, I think is how you pronounce it, that runs on ARM devices, or ARM M1 chip devices. It is running on this machine, but LibreOffice is not being cooperative at the moment, so thus the technical issues today. So, little bit of a hypocritical moment there, but if I were to get up and talk about Android using an iPhone and a MacBook, it would seem a little hypocritical, in my opinion at least, and certainly compromise the integrity of my authority on the matter. And also it would be kind of boring, because again, I just mentioned, I guess a few minutes ago at this point, that Android has already more than established itself as a dominant OS in the mobile device market, and then you have Android tablets, which people can have those like keyboard attachments to it, and it can to some extent serve as a like a PC of some sorts. But to talk about that would be boring. It would be essentially pointless, because the future of Android is solidified at this point. So instead, I want to talk about, don't remember where these came from, but it was supposed to be funny. But this is going to be an anti-Android talk, by the way. So areas of focus I do want to talk about are the identity and identities of potential Linux end users in the future, the likely future of the Linux desktop, and the potential future of the Linux smartphone. I don't know where the word smartphone went, but we'll get there. Anyways, jumping right into the identity or the identities of the future end user, I felt like this is a good time to talk about my professional background. I'm an academic. I teach college English. And one of the things that college English instructors like to do is overthink things and overdefine things. Yeah. So before we get into talking about the current and the potential future end users of Linux and the Linux desktop environment, I want to talk about the history of the term end user and essentially what it can and how I interpret it and within the context of this section of the presentation. So let me make sure I have this right. The first instance that the Oxford English Dictionary records, and that is essentially the authority on the history of words, like the proper term is etymology, but essentially the history of words. The first time they acknowledged this, the term end use, and which is the acta, I guess that's more of a verbal tense kind of thing, and then the end user would be the person who is end using. Anyways, we're not here for grammatical talk. The first instance of the term end use appeared in 1953 in this guy named Paul Charles Berg's his Dictionary of New Words in English. And when I say that it first appeared there, or they first acknowledged that the term end use appeared there, it's kind of hard for a word to first appear in a dictionary, because in order for it to be in a dictionary, you kind of have to acknowledge that it exists in the first place, and you have to be able to observe it in conversational or written use. So I'm more than willing to bet that it would appear in other works if you're willing to go back and dig through some archives of journals, magazines, newspapers, whatever. But the first instance of that word appearing in non-dictionary uses in 1958, it's not too important, but the first time the term end user appears, according to the Oxford English Dictionary, which I'm going to talk a little bit about why it still probably isn't the first use of the word in a second, but it appears in The Economist in 1963 in February, I'm pretty sure, talking about Esso Chemical's policy on refusing to sell chemicals directly to end users. Or essentially, like, which I think is a fairly ethical thing. You don't want random people being able to buy dangerous chemicals. So they'll only sell it to, like, institutions that are, like, certified to handle those chemicals. Anyways, there's also the confusing potential spelling of it, which kind of makes when the term first appeared a little hard to pinpoint. There's the one-word use of it, there's the two-word use of it, and then there's the use of the word end user with a hyphen in between the two words. And although it should be easy to identify those when you're reading through archives, a lot of these things have been digitalized using software that can just take the words out and kind of paste them and represent them as text that you can kind of control F. Control find, and just look for words that way. Problem with that is if you don't check all three of these representations of the words, you don't get an accurate history, and I'm more than willing to bet they either don't have the resources archived in their collection of works they search, or they just failed to look at all three of those terms. Anyways, as far as how I would define the end user, it's typically, yeah, I put it at the top of the slide. Okay, the intended user of a finished product. It first started getting a relevancy to the computer world in the mid to late 1980s, when the personal computer became a pragmatic, practical thing for people to own and use. More so in the 1990s, but I think etymological representations of the word do appear in the 80s. I mean, they have to. But anyways, now getting on to talking about current and future end users. Identifying who the current end users are of Linux it's a complicated thing. One, because most people see it as a they value their privacy. The operating system. Where's my the operating system? Most Linux distributions, not all, represent some level of. Okay, I'm missing a slide I thought I had. Anyways, most of the Linux distributions, with the exception of a few throughout history, do protect Linux users to the best of their capabilities, from data collection, telemetry collection, and things like that, without their given consent. When you get on the internet, that's a whole different story, but generally speaking, if you want privacy, Linux-based operating systems are the way to go. The second and valued element of, or marketable feature of, Linux operating systems that I felt like emphasizing in this presentation is the openness over features mentality. And originally I used the word functionality. And the mentality here is that most Linux users I've came into contact with typically value the open source nature of the operating system and the applications they use on Linux over the ability to do something that you could do on Mac or Windows. And typically that is because there's also an emphasis in Linux on functionality over flashy features. I don't know where those two slides went. Anyways, and functionality over features, this is more of a historical thing in Linux. If you go back to 2015, 2016, I don't know how many years everybody's been using the operating system here. I'm sure many of you have used it much longer than I have. But taking it back to, let's say, Fedora 25. And at that point in time, Linux was still not the most graphically pleasing operating system, but it was a very pleasant experience for those who knew how to use it and were willing to obtain the computer literacy to be able to use it. A few examples of that would be the ability to set a root password separately from your main user account upon installation, which you can still do by once you fully install the operating system. You can change your root password and then remove your main account from the wheel group. But I think this is more of a GNOME change than it would be a Fedora thing. But regardless, those types of features for the individual who's not as computer literate as the average Linux user would be, may seem intimidating, but those touches made it a more user-friendly operating system for those of us who were willing to take the time to essentially learn how to really optimize the operating system that, or the Linux distro that you chose to use. And a probably better example is actually that the freedom that you experience with Linux. You don't have automatic updates that you have to take. You have that stable environment, so you know any kind of development work or any work at all isn't going to be ruined because of an update. You can create that solid, stable environment that, whereas as long as your hardware doesn't give out, you've got pretty much a guaranteed working computing experience. Anyways, interfaces as a whole, though. They've started to try and cater to, I don't want to say less computer literate individuals, because you can be an amazing programmer and just not really like the OS experience, or know much about just swapping OSs or whatever. Surprisingly enough, I've seen it happen on multiple occasions where you have great programmers, but if you ask them to install any operating system or even virtualize something, it's a funny but sad scene. And again, just rolling with the Fedora example, some of the isms they've changed to make the installation process a little bit more streamlined, which for those of us who like to customize our operating systems, is a little bit more frustrating because you have to do all those changes after you install the operating system. But it does open the distribution up to a wider audience. And another element is those who were complaining about Linux's failure to support certain applications or certain, they had complaints that they couldn't do something on Linux. A lot of apps are starting to go to cloud-based computing type experiences. And one example is Office 365. For those who really don't like the LibreOffice experience, a lot of my friends, I've tried to push it on them. A lot of my students, I've tried to push it on them, and they've just been like, no, Microsoft Office has a cleaner look. Well, now you can use Office 365. They have Linux support for it now, and you have reduced featured versions of Microsoft Office. And you don't really get the source code to those, like the Office suite, but you do get the source code to the app that talks to the cloud, so I guess it's a step in the right direction. But essentially, the future Linux end users can really be anyone, and I know I was talking to some of you earlier today about how you have people who are not the most computer savvy, don't work in the industry, and don't really do much other than browse the internet and just maybe type up a few documents. That's been a easily accomplishable task on Linux for a while now, but the fact that more people are learning about it and are becoming accepting of it means that Linux is growing. And although the statistics may not reflect it explicitly quite yet, it is a sign that the community is changing. So it'll be a slow process, but that is one thing to keep in mind, and as far as the future goes, is that the image of the Linux end user is ultimately always changing. And one element, we missed the 30th Linux anniversary, right, because of the pandemic, I think. One article celebrating the 30th birthday was talking about how the Linux in general is about the possibilities. It always has been and always will be. I think the guy's last name was Warren, but I don't remember for sure. Anyways, and that kind of emphasizes the theme throughout this presentation. And that mentality is always going to push changes in who is using the Linux environments and how they're using it. All right, so second element I want to talk about, future of the Linux desktop. Let me get a drink of water before I continue. And I probably should have used a different word other than desktop, because taking things from a very simplistic-minded end-user's perspective, you can define the term desktop in two ways. There's the graphical environment where you have all of your apps, or there's the desktop computer itself, and it seems like a trivial thing to distinguish between, but I think a better way to talk about this is to talk about the future of the Linux end-user environment as a graphical environment, because in theory, there is the identification of a Linux end-user who does use the server environments. They're the maintainers of it, and they are the person who uses the finished product that is the server operating system. So, in theory, anybody who uses Linux is an end-user, but more specifically, we want to focus on the graphical environments for this talk, or that's what I want to do at least. I'm happy to talk about the server environments afterwards, but that I know little to nothing about that. I'm a medievalist by trade, so I consider the fact that I'm on Linux and doing what I can with it impressive in its own right. Anyways, One observation that I've noticed for several years now, but especially with the M1 environments and the focus on ARM-based laptops in recent, I'd say the past 2 or 3 years especially, I'm starting to wonder if the future of the end-user computing experience is going to be mostly ARM. And I don't think ARM based processors are going to be the solution for every computing experience. There are some tasks that just need those more power intensive chips, but the M1 MacBooks that have ARM processors in them have proven that an end user experience can be actually a positive one. Prior to this, you had Raspberry Pis, Pinebook Pros, and it's really and then there was also the Microsoft Surface RT for one version of the tablet, I think. They killed it, and then we'll talk about Microsoft in a minute. Anyways, it's really, really unfair to compare this $2,000 MacBook Pro that has, I can't remember, 12 cores in it and a ridiculous amount of RAM compared to the $200 Pinebook Pro, the Raspberry Pis that we can buy, or even the Surface RT, but that had a different issue that is what I would assume to be Microsoft related, or Windows related specifically. But the demonstration that Apple did with these computers and the previous generation, this is the 2021 version. I didn't really want the first iteration just because I didn't know how these were going to turn out, but they seem really promising, and we've already gotten Linux working on them. We haven't gotten it working well yet, but, and when I say we, I mean the Linux community. I have had no programming or development involvement in that whatsoever beyond unofficial testing, I guess. But somebody had to do this demonstration because although the Pinebook Pros and Raspberry Pis are cool devices, they're not going to show anybody who's not computer literate and aware of what the devices are meant for. It's not going to show anybody a positive experience where they're going to want to continue trying to use Linux. And although we're not there yet on the MacBook Pros where we can use Linux on them successfully, I've already experienced more promise myself, like promising results, than I ever did on the Raspberry Pis. Even the 4 and 8 gig ones, or 4 and 6 gig, I don't remember what the Raspberry Pi 4s were, but the ARM experience up until recently has been, I would say, relatively unimpressive. And I think things are starting to change. Just the ARM experience on laptops and full-blown imitation PC, like trying to replace the x86 processor. Yeah. Those attempts have been unimpressive. Of course, our phones, mobile devices running iOS and Android have shown amazing results. Computing experiences up in, or not up until, for many years at this point. But the ARM devices that are trying to implement laptops or PCs is becoming more common. Like I said earlier, you have the tablets as well that have the keyboards. Apple's really pushing those. And although that's not necessarily Linux related, I think it's important to establish that the computing experience is slowly but steadily moving towards ARM processors. And that's important because there are pros and cons to that in regards to how Linux can take advantage of that with its smartphones and stuff. There is the theoretical eco-friendly or power-saving features of ARM. It's lower power, so in theory you're not consuming as much power. I'm not sure if that's necessarily true, depending on what tasks you're trying to complete. If you start just doing power-intensive tasks, I'd assume you'd eventually end up consuming the same amount of power. But I haven't tested that personally yet, so I won't go any further, and I'm sure somebody in the audience can address the matter after I'm done with my rambling. There is the eco-friendly element to it, and there's also the fact that Linux has been in the ARM environment for much longer than other operating systems like Microsoft or even Mac at this point. Although Mac went really hard with their first laptop-based or attempt at a PC implemented for imitating experience. I think the Linux community is going to have better, that experience counts for something. I'll just say that. And now as far as the cons go, I think that the problems that we're going to experience here as far as getting Linux to run smoothly on ARM-based devices is mostly the same thing, the same problems we're having on smartphones right now. You have Androids, you have iPhones, or more so Androids. iPhones have lesser hardware, but since you can optimize the operating system, you can afford to kind of have lesser hardware and still get a better experience. But as far as Androids go, so many more of them, you just have to have better hardware. Those promising hardware performances, they're nice, but when you have the operating system locked to the device, and if you try and erase that operating system and flash your own, you risk breaking the device and essentially killing it. And obviously, I can demo Asahi for anybody who wants to see it. There's not a lot to see at the moment, other than you can download and install some themes. And if you have an Ethernet cable or a wireless card to plug in, then you can get Wi-Fi. So obviously it's possible. We've gotten UB ports on Nexus 5s before, and there's a long list of devices where Linux can run beyond those. But the process for installing Linux is a much more complicated experience than installing Linux on an x86 processor. So that's going to be an uphill battle as far as the evolving end-user population goes. As if I'm correct as far as this prediction goes, the focus or the emphasis on ARM-based processors in end-user devices or PC, x86 PC, I guess, imitations, or laptops, whatever you want to call them, which actually it includes desktops too. Microsoft announced less than a month ago an ARM-based desktop, which will be interesting. Hopefully it'll be better than the Surface RC. Anyways, let's move on to Linux smartphones, because that seems like a good segue. I'm sure we all remember the failure of the UB ports or the Ubuntu touch phone in, I think, 2014. Really killed the motif of a lot of Linux users who were really excited for it. But I think it was in 2018 when it was announced. When Purism announced the Librem 5, things got a little bit more optimistic. And although the phone took several years to come into a reality where people could actually purchase it and get their hands on it. And there were some bugs at first, but from my understanding, the user experience has gotten reliable with the Librem 5. It's also $1,000 for a phone that is, as far as performance goes, not up to par with present-day competitors. And then there was also the Pine phone, which I don't want to speak for sure, but I know I saw people getting the Pine phone way before anybody got the Librem 5. And I know I got my Pine phone here, which, again, happy to demo after, for $150, which is, the Librem 5 did start off at an introductory price, I think, of like $600, something like that, but I guess inflation caught up with them, I don't know. But the PinePhone had a lot more success from what I can tell. They've gone through multiple batches, and both phones have actually gone to a produce on demand model, I'm pretty sure. But the hardware was kind of the focus of Pine 64's PinePhone, and it fell to the responsibility of software developers to really come up with an operating system, whereas PureOS came with the phone and it was pretty much guaranteed to work, or you could probably return the device. Anyways, both phones were unreliable at first. Both have come a long way, and I'll say that in my experience, it's still not. I haven't used the Librem 5, actually. I've just observed others' use of it. But as far as PinePhone's use, there are operating systems. My two favorite are probably Postmarket OS and then a spinoff that I found on GitHub, I'm pretty sure, of Fedora that is meant to serve on the PinePhone. The developer community was so nice in helping me overcome some of the issues I ran into. And you can essentially turn it into a mobile desktop or a UMPC at that point. There were hardware issues at first with the first two Braveheart editions of the phone with the USB-C port. If you knew how to solder, easy fix. I don't trust myself to make those fixes, so I just left it as it is. And I thought it'd be fun to show the evolution of the PinePhone someday. Not going to do it anymore because there's just too many versions of it. Anyways, even today, I don't see it as a reliable device. I haven't had that positive of an experience with any of the operating system as far as reliability goes. But that's my experience. I know several people who use it to act like right now as their daily driver phone, and if it works for them, great. I know that it has a better reliability rate in big cities. Atlanta, which is where I go to school and teach, it didn't give me many problems, but I've seen more success in New York City. I'm guessing because they have cellular setups for more international, band setups. I'm sure there's a more appropriate phrase for that, but another issue is the 5G. If we're talking about trying to get a more diverse or even just accepting a more diverse Linux end user population, the idea of not having 5G just because it's kind of one of those flashy terms right now, or it used to be, and now it's almost an expectation, I think, with new phones. That's a problem. It is an easily addressable problem with future versions of the phone, I would argue. I'm not so sure about the software side. I'm not too knowledgeable on the software networks, but there's still a long ways to go, I guess, is the point here, as far as expectations of a flagship or mid-tier phone go. As far as a budget phone goes, you could probably install a open source or a basic level of Android or basic version of Android and get a relatively comfortable experience. But it's not a device that I think is ready for mass usage yet, and I think it still has a long way to go. That being said, I don't think that's necessarily a problem. I started out with a pessimistic mindset about it, but if you think about it, not every Linux device has to be marketable to the mass populations, and that's part of what made Linux great for so long, is the fact that it works for the people who want to use it, and they're usually the ones developing it anyways, so kind of works out. And I guess the fear at that point is just losing the Linux population as a whole, which that won't happen. It's a necessary tool for development environments where you need a stable environment. And although I think the professional versions of Microsoft, like Windows at this point, you can stall updates, but in general, Linux is a more controllable environment, I would argue, and the backwards compatibility is better too. But I'm probably preaching to the choir at this point. Anyways, that's what I've got for everybody. It's the topic of the future of Linux is such a massive one. It's hard to narrow it down to like one 45-minute discussion. I think I've probably went over that at this point. Just about okay. Just enough time for questions, concerns, and all that stuff, or grievances. But, yeah. That's all I've got for everyone. So, any questions, concerns, rebuttals? Yes. Yes. Joke is, I would say that's a stretch. What do you mean by a joke? Like, no, it's a licensing of hardware. I agree with you for Linux-based platforms, but as far as the general end-user market, you're right, but why would companies not want that? It forces you to buy new devices. It is a social issue, but I think it's a reality regardless. And I agree with you that it has a lot of fixes that need to be made, for sure. I think I'm more speaking of it as an observed, that's my predicted reality, more so than I agree with it. Does that make sense? Agreed. Very true. And it's a problem. It's a real problem. Hold up. These, for the record, these are not meant to be, like, short-term predictions, for the record. That is great to hear. What is it called? So they're working on the kernel itself for it. Okay. Yeah. Understandable. Yeah. questions, concerns, grievances? Oh yeah, for sure. They're I don't want to say any user interface, but any generally acceptable usable interface, but just to be technical about it. But generally speaking, yeah. Depends on if you consider it Android a Linux-based distribution or a Linux distro or not. The counter argument is it's an altered, which is a bad counter argument, I'll give you, that it's an altered version of the kernel, and you lose the Libre element of the entire operating system, from my understanding of the argument, and. Again, like I said, if I were to consider Android a Linux distribution, then this entire talk is useless at that point. Yes, it is. And the most technical, is that how you define a Linux distro, though? I'm not disagreeing with you. I know other people do. I'm not saying it's the right answer, but I know people do not like to consider Android a Linux distro. Okay, that's fair. I would agree. I would certainly agree with that. Yeah, I'd agree. Yeah, regardless of what it is, and sure, I agree. But if you account for that, then again, the talk is essentially useless. I guess my goal at this point, and I should have emphasized this more, is to emphasize the Libre or the free and open source versions. I mean, there's non-free parts of almost any Linux distro other than maybe PureOS. Yeah. Yeah. That's fair. I was about to mention it, yeah. But that's going to require a more standardized platform for ARM, won't it? Yeah.